The sweet, sweet memories you gave of me, you can't beat the memories you gave of me.
Take one fresh and tender kiss,
the memories you gave of me.
Add one.
I was born in Clayville, Rhode Island, April 30th, 1926. We lived on a very large dairy farm, about 1,200 acres, overlooking the Scituate Reservoir. And it was a wonderful way to grow up because we had cows and horses, and I had a pony at age 5. And my father was retired. He had been president of the Jocelyn Manufacturing Company, which was a very substantial braid operation, braid meaning shoelaces and that sort of thing. We had, I think it was 17 mills in the state of Rhode Island and headquarters in Providence. And this all ended when the state of Rhode Island and the city of Providence took over the land that these mills were on, including 5 villages, by eminent domain, and turned it into the largest reservoir in the eastern part of the country. So, I grew up with ponies, pony at age 5, fishing every morning with, as long as my father was alive. We'd go fishing on a pond that we had, and it was a wonderful, wonderful way to grow up. Eventually, I went off to school in Providence. But still, I had 500 chickens I was responsible for, and so it was a neat way. I often tell people that I'm a farmer at heart. It's not dandruff on my shoulders, that's hayseed up there, hayseed. My best friend Bob Kelsey would come out in the summers and we would work on the farm together. In fact, we had a 1938 Dodge truck. And although we really didn't have licenses, we ran the truck delivering hay to other farms around and, you know, made a few dollars in the way of summer occupation. It was a lot of fun. I remember school very well because I had wonderful teachers. In fact, a succession of wonderful teachers. I think if I were to be asked what my favorite would be, I think Miss Pixley in the fourth grade was fabulous. I think so, because she thought I was her favorite student, which is a little embarrassing. And then Mr. Allen, in seventh grade, headed up the Moses Brown Bicycle Club. And we had regular meetings, and weekends we'd go on short trips. And then I went for a 8-week bicycle trip all over New England and Canada with him, 5 other boys. And I remember coming back to Providence in a rainstorm and being photographed in front of the city hall after this long, wonderful trip. My memories of Moses Brown are wonderful. I enjoyed that school so much, in fact, more than college, really. I lettered in 4 sports. My marks were very good. I graduated with honors from Moses Brown. Made great friends. I think probably you make your best friends in high school, ones that you never ever forget. I met my first wife, Natalie, at age 14 and dated her religiously and without exception until we got married in 1948. And that was all part of the wonderful high school experience. I'm a junior. My father was William H., but they call him Harry, which was his middle name. And because he left us when I was 7, my memories are sharp in many ways, but a lot of it is sort of a blur. My mother, Corrine, had to fill me in on details. And one of the things I remember was that every morning, because I was his first son and he'd had 5 daughters before that, he just wanted to be with me, and so he'd pull the car up in front of the front door, and as soon as I had a little breakfast, off we'd go. I rode in the front seat with him at terrifically horrific speeds on the dirt roads of the country at that time. And we'd go fishing, or he'd go visit his friends in the neighborhood or business or whatever, and I would just sit happily in the front seat with him. And I remember that very well. I remember riding with him in the morning. He had a great big jumper, and he could clear the high-board fences on our farm with these. And I had a little Prince, my pony, and I'd trot along behind, and he sort of kept an eye on me. And you don't forget that sort of thing, you know. It's really wonderful. And then, of course, we went off to school. I enjoyed prep school immensely. One of the things I did there, and I don't know whether it's of any great interest, but we met some people who owned a huge ranch in Wyoming and needed cowboys during World War II because they'd all been drafted. So I went to Encampment, Wyoming, each year for 3 summers, for 4 months, working on this ranch. And I went with a group of 18 other young men from all under college age. And we had a great time, absolutely great time. We fixed fences, we brought the cattle down from the mountains, and it was a fabulous experience. Then, of course, from there, I went into the service. Well, as I said, my father died in April. I was 7, and he was 59. And I remember it very vividly because his death coincided almost exactly with my birthday, 7th birthday, on April 30th. And mother said, "Billy, go up and see your father. He's not going to be with us very long." And I stood beside his bed, and he took off his ring. And he handed it to me and said, "Billy, you're the head of the family now. Take care of him." And that's all I remember. I was the oldest. My next brother was Walter. Walter was very much interested in the farm, very brave, but a stoic. He went off in the Seabees in World War II. Went ashore in Guam, did some very heroic things, fighting the Japanese, and was awarded a Navy Cross. He was a tough cookie. I had to fight him frequently during my childhood. In fact, he tried to kill me twice. Thank God he missed both times. But then I have a sister, Nancy, and Nancy is still alive at that moment. The next was Teddy, who was a wonderful swimmer. He was ranked as a tennis player in New England. Freckles all over him. He was just a funny kid, a great kid. And I really enjoyed that. And Bobby, next to the youngest, was a handsome ne'er-do-well devil. He played jazz piano like you couldn't believe. Just was good looking. The girls loved him. His music was great. And we had a lot of fun with him. He was one of my favorites. And then my baby brother, Richie, was quiet. The rest of us sort of dominated the conversation. Richie just sort of sat there quietly, kept out of trouble, and had a wonderful, relaxing life. We all grew up. Most of us went to Moses Brown and graduated, then went on to college. And I recall my entire childhood in very, very wonderful terms. My grandfather on the Jocelyn side of the family, William E., died back before World War I, so obviously I didn't know him. My grandmother, Teresa, was a resident in the house briefly before before she died. She died in 1930, so I would have been age four. I can remember walking through the house, though, a tall, I thought, elegant lady. And my mother has lots of anecdotes about them and all the rest. On her side of the family, the Browns, both grandparents had died before I was born, and so I have no recollections of them whatsoever. My grandfather founded William H., it was the Jocelyn Manufacturing Company. In Rhode Island, one of the first water-powered mills was developed in Pawtucket, Rhode Island, the Slater Mill. It's very famous. I think my family had one of the very earliest mills in all of New England. and developed it using water power. We were in the braid business, and at the peak, which was right around 1920, we had 17 mills in Rhode Island alone. Five villages with the mills and all the rest of the houses, all of them taken by eminent domain. All that area is now underwater. All the mills are gone, all the towns are gone, and the towns' names were wonderful, like Richmond, Ponagansett, Clayville, Rockland, all just memories to people. It's now underwater, but we have the nicest reservoir, I think, in the East. Well, after Moses Brown, in order not to get drafted, I took an extra year. And so we graduated age 17 rather than 18, because at 18 they drafted you and you ended up in the infantry in Europe somewhere. I signed up for the V5, which was a Navy Air Force training program. They don't have a separate Air Force any longer. But it was my desire to be a fighter pilot. I just felt that I had the talent for it. Frankly, I wanted to kill Japs. And I loved the program. I applied first, I applied to Harvard and Yale and Brown. Oh, Harvard, Yale, and Princeton, actually, because they all had V5 programs. Yale accepted me, so I would have been class of 48 at Yale. I got down there, and within 2 months, I was transferred to Brown University, which was my hometown, which broke my heart, really. Because they had too many pilot trainees in New Haven. It was the best thing that ever happened to me. Brown University is the most wonderful, wonderful college I could imagine going to. Not only was it close to home, it meant I could get home for mother's meals frequently. My girlfriend that I was dating lived there, and it was a great experience. I played freshman and sophomore football before I realized that the opponents were very large and were all from the coal mining districts of Pennsylvania. And from then on, I worked on intellectual pursuits. So it was a great, great experience. Some people say, what was your most memorable event during the war? And I didn't come under fire. My planes were never fired on, but I was the in charge of the battalion the night that Franklin D. Roosevelt died. And as I was marching my company to the parade grounds, I was told the president had died, and you are in charge of lowering the flag and going through that ceremony. And I'll never forget it. The whole battalion was in tears. This was a terrific, memorable event. I'll never forget that. We were married in 48, and I realized that I had to do something. So I graduated in June from college, got my commission and all the rest, and I went to work for Connecticut Mutual Life in Hartford in September of 1947. I went to work in an executive training program. I think they hired me, but like all the companies were desperate for people after World War II. Their staffs were depleted, they were trying to hire, and so they made me all kinds of interesting offers. And one was this executive program. And when the program was over after 8 or 9 months, I had a choice of remaining as a salaried flunky in a huge bureaucratic home office or going out on my own as a salesman. So I elected to go out as a salesman. No commission, nothing but commissions, no salary. And I started in selling in June of 48 and went on with Connecticut Mutual for 6 or 7 years and set a lot of sales records for them, which was nice. And then I decided to set up my own operation. So I became a general agent for, among other companies, National Life of Vermont. I kept my relationship with Connecticut Mutual, and I selected other top flight companies that would specialize in, say, medical coverage, health coverage, like Union Mutual of Portland, Maine was the best accident health company. I'd find a crack company for group insurance. And I formed this organization called William H. Jocelyn & Associates. And I went out and sought big producers who really didn't like their people they were working with, but thought they'd enjoy working for me. And so we rapidly put together a really crack organization. We were all members of the Million Dollar Roundtable, life members of the Million Dollar Roundtable. And we set a lot of records, and it was a wonderful way to do business. You're totally your own boss. You set your own time, work, time frame, your own objectives. My objective was to work as little as possible and make the most I could. So I would take about 3.5 to 4 months vacation every year. That kept me fresh. It kept me in better shape than the customers I dealt with. They were tired and exhausted, and I was fresh back from Paris or someplace. So it worked out very well. In fact, when I retired, lots of people said, we've noticed no difference whatsoever between retirement and when you were working. You're taking just as much time off. So I'd say it was a grand experience. I would recommend it to any young man. If you're entrepreneurial, try to work for yourself. I mean, the opportunities are so great. I retired in 88, had a wonderful chance to sell my business. And so a lot of things happened. We had a small apartment in Palm Beach. I sold a house in Providence, bought a house in Florida in Palm Beach, and made the transition without missing a step. I mean, I was so used to being a playboy that it was just wonderful. I mean, people say, you're bored with retirement? I can't imagine that. We were never bored.